welcome back at ThingsCon 2016 from Amsterdam, and new guest, someone who gave a talk earlier today as well. So who are you and what do you do?
I'm Peter van Waart. I'm a teacher and researcher at the Rotterdam University of Applied Sciences. And I talked about how to involve citizens in the creation of the smart city.
Well, that is an interesting subject. First of all, a smart city, because it's a definition that can be very broad as well. And also one of the success factors is usually to involve people. So how do you do that?
Yes, exactly. In the early days of the smart city, we saw all those shiny pictures of glossy cities functioning extremely well and clean and secure. But then again, when you look better, they're not the real cities, right? Real cities exist out of people who have motivation to be there and to interact with each other. And in one way or the other, technology will come in. What happened in the latest years is that lots of ideas popped up about implementing technological systems, but the decisions on what that systems do, decision to implement the systems are residing at the side of governments and companies. And we question from our university, from our research group, we question what the position of the citizen is in the decision process and also the design process of such systems.
And what should the position be of the citizen?
What should the position be? Well, actually, designing the systems, of course, it looks like that we're talking about the system, but actually we have to talk about the world we want to live in the future, and then see how this technology can help us in achieving that. And that's, I think that's still a trouble and still a challenge to find out how we should do that. But one thing we know is that, of course, people are not very much aware of what the Internet of Things is about or what big data is really doing in the city. Although everyone is using Facebook and other social media and continuously is interacting with Internet of Things systems, but people are not aware of that. So I think awareness is the first step for that. And the second step would be to give people the means to act upon their findings and to act upon their visions, how this world should look like in the end.
And the funny thing is that in the past we had a system that was called democracy, where people could just vote for people and had confidence in it, and these people would just make sure that it was the future was built. And these same governments have been trying to create these smart cities, and now it suddenly seems not to work really. So now we're square one at the citizen, and so we're full circle. So I'm still wondering, first of all, do you have examples where cities did projects where they involved citizens in a proper way?
Yeah, well, the traditionally Scandinavian countries are doing a pretty good job in this participatory society and also participatory designing. It's from the tradition from the 60s and the 70s that they involved laborers in the industries, teachers in schools, etc., etc. So there you have the kind of consensus model where people can have a voice in the decisions that are at stake. So, also in developing smart cities, the Scandinavian countries try to continue with that approach, and I think they do a pretty good job. When you look at other cities, like famous cities as Songdo and Singapore, which are very much controlled by governments in combination with companies, there you see the cities that are really designed at the table and implemented as such as a grand plan, and then people have to see how they fit in that system that was designed without their consent in certain ways.
Okay, so these are certain areas there. You example of a project in a Scandinavian country or in Singapore that is actually working?
In the Scandinavian, you can find lots of projects, but most of the time they are small scale projects. I know I'm working in the city of Rotterdam, and there's a good example in that city that citizens who were concerned about the air quality of their neighborhood started to use sensors to collect data about this environmental pollution themselves. And with that data, they got a very much very stronger position in the negotiations with the local government. So that's one example. But actually, also the examples without technology exist. For example, which is a kind of participatory sensing project, we would say, is the National Bird Count in the Netherlands, where people are asked for one day per year to look into the garden and to count all the birds they that show up, and report that numbers to this one body who registers what the bird population in the Netherlands is. But also before that, around the national airport, people living in that areas and who have very much problem with the airplanes flying over also started already in the 80s or the 90s to collect data about the noise they experience in their living environment due to the planes flying over and landing and etc. So there are strong examples on how people can take action themselves and also make use of technology to organize themselves in collecting data and information to empower their own position in the negotiation with other parties.
You also talked about the step of creating awareness amongst and civilian people. There's probably many ways to do that. I can imagine that certain governments think, let's create awareness, let's create a TV commercial. And there must be also better ways, I suppose. Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, what we now have a project in which we go into neighborhoods. We try to connect with activities that are happening there already, and then have a specific spot, a specific location, which we call Neighborhood Lab, and bring in some technologies that we prepared for the people that are very easy in use. So actually, this actually assumption when you can bake a cake or assemble your own IKEA chair, why can't you make your own smart device? So we don't believe that people are too dumb to understand technology, but they never had the opportunity to really understand or the technology, or never had the means to experiment with the technology, and that's what we try to stimulate do that in the locations where the people are really living and have real issues they are concerned about.
Now, once you created awareness, that would be really great, and then people start doing projects. But
you still need to have a government that is going to willingly listen to these people and wants to cooperate with them. And if you hit a brick wall there, then people are no longer motivated, and it will be very hard to get motivated again. So how do you deal with that?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's not a simple design process. It's actually a design process with many open ends, with many stakeholders that are involved, many interests, of course. And we just had a great discussion this morning about is technology the only thing what we need in this neighborhood lab, or do we need more? Yes, of course we need more. We need journalism also to address issues that are at stake in the city, or to expose the power structures from the municipality with the companies in the city, for example. We also need other places to go to, not just our technological lab, but also theaters or squares where people can interact and discuss with each other about what's happening in their living environment and in their city. So that's I think the challenge we have now as designers of technology, that we have to blend in daily life as it is for real.
And then comes the other thing. Once you're successful, it's always great to show that to a global audience, because before you know, all neighborhoods are going to start to do the same thing. Are there already platforms where you can just learn from other neighborhoods where they designed something or did something and that you can adopt to or use?
There have been only a few platforms that were able to connect to the data streams that people are provided. I'm sorry, I lost the question.
let's take it a little bit more specific. Are these projects, are these open source? Can they be used by other neighborhoods?
Right.
How can you find them? Can you share them?
What we need to do is when we don't want large systems being implemented top down, then we have to find how we can organize through a bottom up approach. How to organize the design of such a system. So it is very situated. People in a certain area will come up with an idea or the installation how that works. And it's not that we can use those results, not those artifacts that are constructed right away for all the other areas. But I think that we can learn from our approach and our methods and apply those methods to other areas. And in the end, scaling up everything might be to connect all those areas together. So then we would have much more an emergent process of a city that is becoming smarter rather than a top-down approach that in one night the city has turned over to a smart city right away.
I'm also looking to things like, for instance, I live in Amsterdam, and is there a way where I could just browse to successful projects in Rotterdam that I could say, okay, this is a project about air quality or garbage collection or whatever, anything,
yeah.
that was a successful project, because I'm thinking about it to do that in my own city and my neighbor is interested as well. I want to start this, I don't want to develop it all myself, maybe some off-the-shelf kind of blueprint that I can use.
Yeah, it's a combination, I think. I think when you go to researcher groups and universities, you will find some groups who have this website where they can show those projects that they've done with the citizens. And you will also find what technologies they've used for that, because there are lots of providers of technology who make technology that can connect or with which you can create smart things that people can use, like the Little Bits or the Arduino is one of the first examples, although that's a kind of complex. But you have a range of products you can use for that. Only the providers of that system will not tell us how what we should do with that. So what we need also next to that, and I think that is what lots of the researcher groups are now doing, is to come up with a program or a campaign or a course, a seminar for people to get used to the technology and to learn how to apply the technology for their own benefit.
And not only the technology, I mean, just the success of the project can also create awareness in other cities and in other places or other neighborhoods, perhaps.
Yeah, and you still have to keep in mind that it's not about the technology, it's about what people want with the city, right? So the people in Rotterdam who were concerned about air quality are still concerned about air quality, only now they know how to use technology in the fight for their cause. So I think in the end that still is most important. The idea that people have about how their city should look like in the end. And then we think about how technology can help in that.
So there's still a lot of work to do.
We have still a lot of work to do. I also think it never ends. So, and that's good because that's what life is, and that's how we have to fit in the technology in people's lives.
Thank you very much.
Okay, you're welcome.